word grace in its simplest form means God doing for you what you can't do for yourself. And all of us need the grace of God. But how many of you know that when that isn't enough, guess what? Mercy kicks in. And when mercy kicks in, his mercies are new every day. I remember the little girl that I met once on Flatbush Avenue in front of Brooklyn Tabernacle. A little young girl. She was on the street. She couldn't have been 12 years old. She was selling her little brother's Pampers on the street. And I remember meeting that little girl selling her brother's Pampers on the street in front of Flatbush, in front of Brooklyn Tabernacle, right on Flatbush. Young little girl, about 12 years old. And I remember having the opportunity to talk to that little girl. And I said, baby, what is it that you're doing? And she, I'll never forget what she said. She said, my daddy, he's desperate for drugs. And he told me to sell the Pampers, to sell my brother's Pampers on the street so that I could give him the money so that he could go and buy drugs. Guess what? When you're desperate, you'll do anything. And what he's saying is, let's get desperate about him. Hallelujah. Somebody ought to say amen. Let's get desperate about God. Come on, put your hands together. It's time that we get desperate. That we get desperate about God. That the things of God. Desperate.
There's this little bakery close to where I live. Every time I walk in there, they have the hand of Jesus, and he has the nail prints in his hand. And then they show another hand, the hand of a man. And you'll notice that in the photograph, the hand that is reaching, it's interesting that it's not the hand of the man that's reaching towards Jesus, but it's Jesus' hand reaching towards the man.
Oh, come on, put your hands together. That's good news. That's good news that his hand is reaching out to hold on to us, to hold on, hold on, hold on, hold on, hold on to Jesus. At least one time or another, we've considered to quit because we're just tired. But I want you to understand that when you're weak, he is strong. And when you can't hold yourself up, there's somebody that will hold you. And his name is Jesus Christ.
Joseph Maldonado was born on a hot summer night in August of 1952. He was born in New York City on the Lower East Side. His mother Maria had given up hope of having a son. She already had four daughters. When she returned to work, she entrusted young Joey to his older sister Gladys. The family that included his father Miguel lived on Norfolk Street. His father would die of a massive heart attack at the age of 53. Joey was just 5 years old. The first 3 years of his life were like any other kid's. until something happened that would change his life forever.
From what my mother told me, you know, I battled a fever. That's how she knew that I was sick. I had a fever for 3 days. And the fever, no matter what she did, lo baño de alcoholado, and everything else that she did, and giving me Tylenol and aspirin, trying to bring the fever down. Here at age 3, the fever would not go down. And so finally she took me to the hospital. And when they took me to the hospital, they had diagnosed me.
Polio would have a profound effect on young Joey's life. He would spend the next 10 years in and out of hospitals. He would endure 6 major surgeries and go through many months of therapy. He also spent many hours in an iron lung. Occasionally, he would come home on the weekend.
On Friday, they would release me from the hospital, from Bellevue Hospital and NYU, both of those hospitals. And then I'd be home Friday and Saturday, and Sunday afternoon, I had to go back to the hospital. Those were some of the hardest times of my life. And the reason for it is because once I had experienced freedom, you know, from the hospital and eating real food, Spanish food at home, and I had friends in the neighborhood that used to ride me around in the wheelchair and running around on the Lower East Side in front of the projects with my crutches, I had been free. And how depressing it was then to pack up my bag and then head back to the hospital and spend another week. I went to school in the hospital for years.
Throughout those difficult years, little Joey could always depend on his mother. He recalled one incident that has stood with him all his life.
I can remember that as if it was yesterday. My mother running with me to take me back to the hospital. I had spent the weekend, and so she's running for the bus. And she's running for the bus. She's holding me, and she fell. And she fell. The floor, there was snow. There was just powdered snow. And she slipped on the snow and she fell. And without missing a beat, she just got right back up, picked me up, and just got on the bus. When she got on the bus, I remember sitting alongside of her and seeing the blood trickle from her knee. And she didn't skip a beat. She didn't pay any attention to it. I remember telling her, "Mama, you hurt yourself, you're bleeding." You know, she said, "No te apures, está bien." And she was concerned if I was all right. "Are you okay? Tú estás bien?" And I said, "No, yo estoy lo más bien. I'm fine, Mom." She hurt herself in an effort to protect me. That's a love. That's a special love that my mom has for me, and the special love that I have for her. Somebody said, "Pastor, you sound like you're a mama's boy." And I said, "You're right, I am." I learned the secret. They said, if you honor your mother and your father, you'll live a long life. So I guess I'm going to be an old man.
In December of 1955, little Joey appeared on the front page of the New York Daily Mirror.
It was Christmas Eve. And the reporter arrived at NYU. And I was leaving that hospital for the first time. I was walking out of the hospital after I had been diagnosed and after I had surgery, my first surgery. I was walking out, coming home for one of those breaks from the hospital, and they caught me in the foyer. And sure enough, it's Christmas Eve, and the caption says, you know, in the article it says, his greatest gift is that he walks. You know, his greatest gift during Christmas is that he walks out of the hospital.
He also appeared in a medical journal in 1956 that dealt with children stricken with polio. Merry Christmas. Finally, after 10 years, little Joey left the hospital for the last time. But the boy that left was a bitter, resentful young man. His mother began taking the family to St. Teresa's Church on Rucker Street.
I was so angry at the world. I was angry at everybody and everything. I had spent all those years in the hospitals. Most of my life was in a wheelchair with crutches. I didn't have the privilege of playing like other children played. I was desperate to fit in. And that's when I discovered the streets. I went to the handball court, which is right across the street from 340 Cherry Street. And I went to the handball court and I saw, you know, the president of and the vice president of this gang which is a very well-known gang called the Ballerino Dragons. And I saw when they came to the handball court, they took off their jackets and they had guns. And they put their jackets on the bench and they put their guns and covered their gun with their jackets. And I realized how much respect these men got. And then they allowed me to play. And the first time they allowed me to play was $5 a man. I remember somebody put up the $5 because I didn't have $5, but we won. And I said, you know, this is a good way to make money and you make friends. And so what I did is I lived on that handball court. I was determined that I would be one of the best handball players. But when I saw these guys with their guns and the respect that they got, I said, one day, I'm going to be like that. I'm going to be just like that. I'm going to have that kind of respect. I will carry a gun. And sure enough, that's exactly what I did. And on my 14th birthday, I turned 14 years old. And my birthday gift was a .357 Magnum with an upside down holster that was given to me by my cousin in Coney Island.
In his first summer home, young Joy was given the chance to experience life in the country. 75 years earlier, a Pennsylvania minister had asked members of his church to provide country vacations for New York's neediest children.
They were signing children up and to go away for 2 weeks. And when my mother found out that she was able to sign all of us up, my sisters and myself, to go to camp for free, she signed every one of us. I went to Pennsylvania. And there, I was sent to a home, which was a farmer. And the farmer had five children and his wife. And it was there, that was the very first time that we gathered around a table. And we bowed our heads and pray. We prayed for the food. You know, when you grow up in the project, you don't bow your head to pray, because if you close your eyes and you're praying for your food, somebody's going to eat your food. So that was the first time I had learned, about prayer, and the first time I had really heard about Jesus Christ. I remember it was at that Fresh Air Fund is when I had heard about Jesus Christ. They gave me a Bible, my first Bible, which I still have today. My Bible, on one side of the cover, it says, "Sin will keep you from this book, and this book will keep you from sin." And on the back side of that Bible, it says, "Don't steal this Bible for fear or shame, for Joe Maldonado is not your name. For when you die, the Lord will say, 'Where's that Bible you stole that day?' And if you say, 'I do not know,' the Lord will say, 'Please step below.'" And so the farmer knew I was coming back to New York City. It was at that camp that I asked Jesus Christ to come into my heart. And he gave me that Bible. And I came back to New York City. And we and my sisters and we all said, you know, we don't want to go to the big Catholic church anymore. We want to go to this small little church called Trinity, Assemblies of God.
One day from his window, Joey saw firsthand the danger that streets could bring.
It was right from here, looking down into this park. It was the very first time there was a gang war. A number of gangs had come together, and it was the first time I had ever seen somebody shot and shot dead right in this park. That left a deep impression on my heart and on my mind at that time.
Joey's newfound exposure to the streets and his determination to fit in his neighborhood would eventually lead him to join the gang. He was just 14 years old.
It was important to wear a nice hat, a black hat with matches in it, and I became a junior member of the Ballerino Dragons. But that gang, soon after I joined, kind of began to collapse and fall apart as a result of the drug activity.